Hey, I have a quick poll before we get rolling here, because we want to do our book study. So I have a question, though, and just raise your hand when I ask your question. For how many of you are you interested in doing a book study with the stuff that we're walking through? Okay. How many of you, Wednesday night's a bad night for you to do that? Okay. How many of you would rather do that, you'd be able to do it on a different night? Okay. How many of you, like, what if it was like Sunday after church? Okay. Yeah, you definitely are welcome to bring me food. That's I'm absolutely good with that. Okay, I'm just trying to get a sense, because we want to have maximum impact. Not impact, we want to have maximum amount of people that can show up, and so we want to figure out how to accommodate best as possible, and frankly, I think Melinda's getting tired of just hanging out with me on Wednesday night. So I spoke for her. Maybe she enjoys it. It's possible. So we're going to go ahead and meet, not this Wednesday night, because we've got an elders meeting, but we'll start next Wednesday. In the meantime, maybe I'll kind of explore some other options and see maybe if we can net some more people in that. In any case, oh yeah, that was my other question. How many of you would join it online if you could zoom into it? Okay, a few of you, excellent. All right, and Jan in the back. Jan's actually tried and not got through, that's bad. So the other thing I wanna make sure to announce is that next Sunday, May 22nd, is our service team meeting. So after the service, We're gonna hang out for a little bit. We'll be feeding you. It's not a potluck, so you just come prepared to eat. And we're gonna get a chance to just kind of cover what's going on in terms of our service teams and break out a little bit in teams, just to touch base on some stuff that's hard to hit on a Sunday morning. It'll be short and to the point, good food, and we'd love to have you there. Also, if you're interested in exploring what it might look like or what does go on service teams-wise, you're welcome to show up, and you'll get a good view there. We do want you to know that it's Lisa Underwood's birthday today, so happy birthday. Make 26 look good. Let me pray. Father, we lift you up this morning in worship. We gather every week. We gather together to worship you, Father. We pray that this morning, like every week, you would remind us how profound and meaningful it is to be a part of a body of believers, a family of church, Lord, that you would draw us into your word, that you would move and speak to us in your spirit, and that you would be glorified and honored in our praise. Amen. Amen.
Please stand and join us for worship this morning.
Thank you. joy, my hope, I will rest my soul in you. I will rest my soul in you. I will rest my soul in you. Thank you.
Pursues us in the way that you do, that you love us with this reckless abandon, Lord. We are truly so grateful and so humble. We praise your name. Jesus, in your awesome name. Amen. It's fun to worship with you guys. I missed you all last week. Greet somebody next to you. Shake their hands. Give them a hug. Let them know that you see them.
Well, we are in a new series called Forgive, and essentially, well, it's not very cryptic. We're talking about forgiveness. In our book study, and roughly we're following along with a book called Radical Forgiveness by Brian Zond, which I highly recommend. Even if you're not able to pull off the book study, get a hold of this book. It's definitely worth your time, and it's a lot. I'm glad we're teaching along with it, because it's one of those books that you're reading it and you're just thinking, man, this concept, this idea of forgiveness goes way deeper than I ever imagined, you know. And this week, as I was getting ready, at one point I realized what I was trying to do for today was really 4 weeks worth of material. And right now, most of you are sitting there saying, well, that's a shocker, because we do cram a lot of stuff into our Sunday mornings. But I think what I decided and what I'd like to do is I wanted to take a step back from that a little bit, because forgiveness is a bigger deal than we realize. We talked about this a little bit last week, that forgiveness is equal, essentially, to love. And it's love embodied, essentially, which means that it is a deal breaker. It's a non-starter if we're not willing to enter into forgiveness. We also talked last week about how hard a concept that is, because we don't quite understand how it works. We live in this world, and in our lives, there's so much pain and hurt that we experience and that we inflict and regret on others, especially the people we love, for some reason, that it's hard for us to understand, how do we do this? How do I forgive? What makes that even more frustrating is because we really want to. We really do want to forgive the people around us, but sometimes that stuff, it just hangs with us for good reasons and for selfish reasons and for all kinds of reasons, but we can't just let go of stuff. And so what does it look like to forgive? So we're going to be talking about forgiveness for a while. And for one, I think that's good, because it does a service to the topic. But also something that I'm looking for on the side, and maybe this is just the preacher part of me, but man, we cover a lot of information, and then we cover a lot of information, and then we cover a lot of information, and then the next week we give you a lot of information, and I don't know about you, but I'm overwhelmed. I love teaching it, and I love the studying part, but it's like every single week we've got more and more and more and more, and I wonder sometimes about becoming saturated with new stuff. And so I'm excited to spend some time talking about forgiveness and exploring all the ways that it permeates the life of faith, as opposed to just kind of banging it out and going on to the next one. Fair enough? Okay. So if it gets into like week 30, 32, you know, give me a heads up, and I promise it won't be that, but I know you'll forgive me if it is. So this morning, I want to take a step into forgiveness that is an unlikely as it sounds, is actually about the idea of incarnation. The incarnational life and the way that that dovetails into this idea of forgiveness, trying to give us sort of a clear picture of what God means by forgiveness, what it looks like for us to live that out. And a big part of that, a foundational piece of that, is what I would call the incarnational life. Essentially, incarnation, if you speak Spanish, it's carne, carne. The incarnation, the embodiment, we usually refer to that in terms of a deity, the embodiment of a god or something great in greatness. That's incarnation. It's funny, you're exposed more to the idea of reincarnation. We've got that word too, which is essentially what? You're all afraid to say it in church because, like, wait, that's not in the Bible, is it? We got this idea in our heads of reincarnation where it's like you have this other life, or I was something in another life, and there's entire belief systems, religions, God worship that's built around this idea of what happens to you in this next life. I didn't realize how many people who believe in reincarnation that are denied health insurance for having a pre-existing condition. I was so worried no one would laugh at that joke. If you're not laughing, you're still thinking about it. That's good. I guess that's just as well. The incarnational life essentially boils down to this idea of the incarnation of God, who is Jesus himself, right? God become man. And there's this Trinity idea that is so difficult to get our heads around. It becomes clear. This is what I love about the narrative of Scripture. We look at the narrative of Scripture and we get this idea of this strange reality of a triune God, of this God in community, this three persons and yet one God. One of the ways that we understand that or have come to see it in this story of Scripture is Jesus, God incarnate, the Son. God is man who was born as a baby, lived a life, a human life, and was killed as a human. That whole story is the incarnation, the embodiment of God himself. And everything Jesus said and did was a reflection of God. In fact, he said he was God, and yet he said he listened to God, and he proclaimed himself as this Messiah that was being sent from the beginning of the Hebrew scriptures. And the scriptures talk about him being present at creation and permeating all things. And yet here he was as a man and fully God. John 1 is John's Christmas story, is the most bizarre one, where he doesn't really mention the things except to say that Jesus is the Word, and the Word became flesh. And the Word is God and was with God, and the Word is with us and is light. But the biblical authors, the writers and the people that were laying this story out after Jesus were more and more aware that Jesus was God. He wasn't just a prophet. He wasn't just a good guy. He didn't just say a lot of really good things that were worth writing down, but he was God. And not only did they realize that he was God incarnate, but they began to connect all these dots to the scriptures up to that point and realize he really is the fulfillment, the reality of God in the scriptures. Like even going back to Zechariah, where you've got these prophetic writings that are so important to what was going on in that time and in that context, and yet began to ring true in amazingly deep ways to these disciples and this early church after Jesus. When Zechariah says things like, "Behold, your king is coming to you." And they're seeing what's going on there, and yet these people are gathered around the resurrected Christ, and they're realizing this has been the story all along, that God become man on our behalf. So the incarnation. I think Hebrews is one of the spots. I'll just highlight this one just to kind of give you a taste of what the early church was looking at and thinking about as they're reflecting on Jesus. And I just want to throw this out there to you, because sometimes reading the scriptures is like a text message where you're trying to figure out exactly what someone's tone is. But this book of Hebrews is fascinating in the sense that there's a poetic element to this that's hard to translate. But at the same time, this isn't textbook. This isn't theology. This is the book of Hebrews. Beautiful. Long ago, verse 1 of chapter 1, God spoke many times and in many ways to our ancestors through the prophets. And now in these final days, he has spoken to us through his Son. God promised everything to the Son as an inheritance, and through the Son, he created the universe. The Son radiates God's own glory and expresses the very character of God, and he sustains everything by his mighty power and the power of his command. When he had cleansed us from our sins, he sat down in the place of honor at the right hand of the majestic God in heaven. And he goes on, the author goes on, because he's really making a point about angels, people thinking angels were somehow God or more important than people. But the very beginning of this writing in the book of Hebrews just lays out that from the beginning, God had this in mind, that Jesus was there in creation. He was there from the beginning, and all this unfolded so that he could come and be here and be human and save us. That's a whole other conversation, this conversation around salvation, isn't it? It's important. I'll just let you know that right now. Read up on that a little bit. So here's where I'm driving. With Jesus as the incarnation of God, everything that God had done and revealed about himself in the scriptures up to the point of Jesus was pointing to Jesus. And he says, everything you know and understand about God, I am it. And so everything that we want to understand about God, everything that we need to understand when we're looking at the narrative in the Old Testament, all the things that are so difficult for us to grasp, especially when we can't grasp context in some cases, everything is ultimately interpreted through this lens of Jesus. We see God in Jesus. And Jesus then has called us to be this incarnation. Not that we are God in human bodies, let me just put that out clearly, but that we become the body of Jesus. I mean, this is how Paul refers to it, doesn't he? Yes, he totally does. Whew. I'm going to keep going, and just to make sure, because I can't really see that well, so I need to hear that you're breathing. So here's the thing. We as the body of Christ are called to live incarnational lives. And I think the idea of an incarnational life seems to overlap, in fact, maybe is just inextricably connected to a life of forgiveness. The life of a Christ follower, living in accepting forgiveness and offering forgiveness as a life, not as an action or a feeling, is living the incarnational life, living out the life that Jesus started as God incarnate and then indwelling in us as his people. Are you seeing where I'm going here? So here's a great, we looked at this a Good Friday, but John chapter 17, maybe this will help kind of give you an idea what I'm walking through here. John chapter 17 is this crazy prayer that Jesus has for his disciples. And it's interesting because he's like, it's kind of like one of those, like, no pun intended, it's a cruciform prayer where he is talking to God, and he's also kind of talking to these guys beside him. And so the disciples are listening to him as he prays, and this prayer becomes a kind of a heavy benediction. It's a blessing in the sense that he's handing off to these disciples, but it's heavy because he's kind of reflecting, he's ruminating, he's literally at the end of his life because everything's about to go down, and that leads to him being crucified. And he's reflecting on his time here on earth and the fact that he's being released out of that to be joined with God again, that his job as God incarnate is coming to an end, and he's handing this off to these disciples around them. So that's what you want to kind of picture in your head. Jesus, these are last moments. They kind of don't quite grasp that yet necessarily, but these are last moments where he's reflecting and he's handing off to his disciples. So in verse 18, he's talking to God, and Jesus says, just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your truth. He goes on, and then down into verse 25, He says, "Oh, righteous Father, the world doesn't know you, but I do. And these disciples know you sent me. I have revealed you to them and will continue to do so. And then your love for me will be in them, and I will be in them." This existence that we have where Jesus says, God, you sent me and I am sending them. You are in me and now I am in them. I have revealed you to them. I will continue to do so. I am sending them into the world. This is where we stand. A couple thousand years later, starting with those disciples there, where Jesus said, I am pouring into you the authority, the teaching, the understanding of what's been going on in the story to this point, the story moving forward. I am giving you the incarnation of God. What else can we take away from this when we read in the scriptures about the Holy Spirit indwelling in us? When we look in the book of Acts, when we look as this community unfolded and Jesus promised, stay in Jerusalem because I'm going ahead of you and I'm going to send the Spirit on you. And like never before, they experienced God's Spirit descending on a room and descending on a community of people and even individuals experiencing God's Spirit and dwelling in them. What else does that mean if we can't describe that as being the incarnation of God? Again, as a vessel more than as actually being that. But we receive what Jesus passed along to us, which is what he brought to begin with. Do you see that that is meant to be a seamless story? There's not a huge line that's being drawn there. Jesus in that moment essentially is saying like, okay, here's where this goes from here. Nothing changes about what Jesus was doing or saying. In fact, he said, you're going to continue doing all these things that you saw me do and say. It's a transition. It's a passive of a baton, not a completely different story. I hope that's kind of getting clear in your head where I'm headed with that. We are saved into an incarnational life. And this is what this morning really comes down to for me is, have you ever heard me say this before, that most of Scripture is about us and not me? Yeah, we say that a lot here. I don't know how quite to say this, but like this is something that we have been led to. This is not a concept that I invented or I learned in school a long time ago, but as we have come together in worship as Christ the King, this idea that Scripture is so much more about we than me has surfaced, and man, it has changed my life, my understanding of God and of Scripture, and I think it has shaped us as a church community. And so all of a sudden, I'm trying to prepare to talk about forgiveness, and in my mind, I especially have the hurt and how do we forgive, and all of a sudden I come butting up again into this thing that is in the DNA of Christ the King Church, which is, this is about us more than it's about me. It is about me, it's about you, but it is about us, it is about me for us. You have that phrase kind of circulating in your mind that we say over and over again? Same thing with forgiveness. We are saved into an incarnational life. I am saved into a life of forgiveness for us and for the world around us. That means living this incarnational life of embodying Jesus as he handed it off to us as the church. That is an us movement, which means it requires an us. Whatever you learn about forgiveness, whatever you experience in forgiveness, whatever skills and disciplines and movements and behaviors that you bring to the table, that happens here in us and is supported and fostered and nurtured in us and is not accessible by sheer force of will. Are you hearing me on that? I think a big reason about that is because, as it turns out, forgiveness is not an emotion. Brian Zahn says that in his book, and that kind of hit me when he said that. Forgiveness is not an emotion. It's not a feeling, which is a bummer because I think I've been waiting my whole life to feel right about forgiveness in certain situations, and now I'm realizing that maybe I won't ever, and I've been kind of barking down the wrong tree on that. Forgiveness is not entirely a feeling or an act. It's not an emotion, but is a life of becoming Christian. We're saved into an incarnational life. And here's what I mean by that. The birth of Jesus, the incarnation of God, the death of Jesus, and the resurrection are just as connected to salvation as this incarnational forgiveness life is. So when I say I'm saved, when I say I've been saved from my sin, the capital S, big overarching human sin, and my relationship tearing down behaviors, my sins, when I am saved from that, it is because I am embracing the forgiveness that Jesus offers in his life, death, and resurrection. The incarnation is a crucial part of that. I am saved because of the incarnation, and I am saved into it. I keep saying that over and over again. Do I need to keep repeating that? I feel like I'm saying it over and over. I guess it's the point of the sermon. John 15, Jesus says, "This is my commandment. Love each other in the same way I've loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. And you are my friends if you do what I command." There's something going on here in Jesus' teaching about the incarnation of God, the embodiment of God, and how forgiveness is connected to this, in that we love each other. And like I said last week, that word love and the way Jesus describes love and loving God and loving each other, you could put forgiveness into that. And forgiveness is like the action or the picture word of that love, if it helps you understand love better. Forgive each other in the same way I've forgiven you. There's no greater forgiveness than to lay down one's life for one's friends. And you are my friends if you do what I command. Nah, I won't go down that road. Sorry, sometimes you're looking at notes and you're like, I don't know where it's headed. As we move forward into this, there's something that we're going to come up to as we start to walk through the Beatitudes, the Sermon on the Mount, that is where Jesus was headed with all these things to describe this life of forgiveness. But what I really want us to get in touch with today is this idea of salvation connected to incarnation. And this is a hard thing. Maybe that's why I'm having trouble even talking about it. Because we've gone through the Lord's Prayer recently, and we went through that passage right after, and we covered this last week, this idea that Jesus says, if you forgive other sins, your sins will be forgiven. And if you don't forgive other people's sins, God won't forgive your sins. Actually, I just mixed two passages together, didn't I? Jesus says, if you forgive other sins, God will forgive your sins. And he said, if you don't forgive other sins, God won't forgive other sins. And elsewhere, he says, if you forgive people's sins here, they are forgiven. And if you refuse to, they're not forgiven in heaven. And I keep bringing this up over and over again because it's hard to grasp this idea that Jesus took forgiveness and he associated it with salvation, that he associated it with this. And this is hard for us as evangelicals, isn't it? Because we want to say, okay, wait a minute. Jesus died. He died and took care of sin once and for all. I accept Jesus' sacrifice, which means I am saved. And we can go through all these, road of Romans, and we can go through all these specific Bible verses that support this and reinforce this. I accept Jesus, and so I am saved, and nothing can change that. And so I am saved, and I'm trying to live my life in holiness. I'm trying to honor and know and grow deeper with God and in the church community, but I am saved, right? There's nothing that can take that away, is there? And yet, here we've got these verses where Jesus says, if you don't forgive other people, God's not going to forgive you. Or, this is even scarier, if you don't forgive people here, they won't be forgiven in heaven. So what's true then? Can my salvation, can I be unsaved if I'm an unforgiving person? Or can I never be unsaved because Jesus paid that price once and for all and I embraced it? What's the answer there? Yes. How many, man, this is like another ongoing theme. Every time we come across these things, we embrace one of these difficult things in Scripture, we always come up with a tension instead of an answer, don't we? We always come up with this answer, yes, to two things that seem opposed to each other. But the answer is yes. Jesus conquered sin and death. Death entered the picture in the garden, didn't it? All of a sudden, humans die. We sin. You know, we talk about being born into sin, that we reinvent it. Adam and Eve, in this story in Genesis, Adam and Eve started sin. They were this story of original sin, and yet we call it our sinful nature, don't we? Scripture refers even to a sinful nature because I reinvent it myself as soon as I'm born. John was talking about his daughter peeing on him like 10 minutes after she was born. Like, come on. Like, nobody in the Garden of Eden would have done something so heinous. We're born into sin. We're born into death. We weren't meant to die. And Jesus forgives and conquers death. So for me to embrace that relationship with Jesus, and I'm accepting what he already did, which paid the price, it covered, it brings forgiveness and grace for all sin of all time. Yes, I'm in with that. I am accepting this from Jesus, and it's a gift that he offers, and it is complete. I think we can agree on that, and we could walk through Scripture all day long and see how the narrative reflects that. Amen? Also, somehow, and we don't usually talk about them because they seem to contradict, on this other hand, salvation, forgiveness of sin, is very heavily involved with salvation. Somehow those are both true, which is why it is so crucial for us to embrace this idea that learning how to live this incarnational life is about salvation. It's about saving me and you. Not because I might go to hell if I do it wrong. Not because I might experience eternal torment and fire with demons all around me if I fail to forgive you, or you fail to forgive me, or we forget to forgive somebody and withhold that as a church and then forget that God's not going to forgive them. It's not that so much as this incarnational life that says we live out forgiveness for the people around us. That as Christians, we operate with a spirit of forgiveness as opposed to a spirit of withholding. Does that make sense to you? Have you ever seen a group of people collectively operate by withholding forgiveness and grace from other people? Yes, you have. It's how we operate in our world. It's what our country seems to be running on right now. Is grouping together in groups of people, whether it's politics or issues or geographic. We've got people moving here over and over and over again, hundreds of people moving. And what's the first thing that happens when you have a conversation with someone? You know, I came here, but I had to get away from the list of things because I know we're all the same here. We're moving locations so that we can be around the same kind of people that think the same way so that we don't have to be tainted or hurt or infiltrated by the other. What is that except for a life of grouping together in community in terms of what we oppose, in terms of withholding forgiveness and grace and embracing of difference? Do you hear what I'm saying? So what are we called to, and what is our salvation tied to? Again, not are you in or are you out? Are you going to hell this morning, but by this afternoon, you're okay. And then you had that dream last night, and now you're definitely going to hell. And you know, but somehow both our eternity set with God is connected to our ongoing salvation in this life. As the incarnation of God, the baton handed off people of Jesus. And we are not Christians if we are not gathering together in community in the spirit of lavishly handing out forgiveness as opposed to withholding it. And it's just not bad form. It's just not being rude. It's just not bad manners. It's just not, well, they did it to us and we're doing it to them. We'll talk about the golden rule later and slapping the mouth of that. But it is connected to our salvation. I don't know how else to say this. This is important. This is real. This has to do with God's attitude and demeanor and acceptance of us. that we forgive each other. And that starts, as always, here. It starts with me as an individual taking responsibility for myself and saying, yes, I see this, I hear it, I'm not sure how to live that out or how to do it, but I accept this. I am part of the incarnation of God, meant to bring forgiveness and love to the world around me, to subvert systems of power and authority. And I know that I cannot do that by myself. And so I am willing to gather in community. Now, what we need to do here then is figure out how to practice that life of forgiveness with each other, correct? But you're saying, wait a minute. I haven't had to forgive anybody. Nobody in this room has really done anything to me. Well, maybe so-and-so, you know, they grabbed the last coffee and I, you know, but like we get along real great. We're all happy, you know. That's a problem. That means we don't know each other well enough to piss each other off. That means we're not spending enough time together to know that I have fundamental disagreement with you over certain things. My friend Jenny died last week, friend of Jennifer and I, and oh gosh. And here I am right now thinking that maybe I should not cry about that somehow. That's a whole other topic. Jenny died, and it was such a bummer that we couldn't be there, but luckily they streamed it, and so Jen and I got to watch yesterday, and the people who got up and talked about Jenny, who had completely different social, political, economic perspectives, like diametrically opposed to each other, standing up and talking about how much they loved this woman who challenged them but listened to them more than even challenging them, and that challenged them. In a relationship with people who were diametrically opposed to each other. This is how we need to live, but if we don't bother to get to know each other well enough to know that and forgive it and live in it, we are not living this out. We are not living out this incarnational life, which means we're certainly not bringing it to the world around us, which means we're failing in what saves us to begin with. Can you see how important this is? Can you see how useless? All of a sudden, I'm realizing it's so useless for me to try and think of how do I forgive so-and-so, although that should be an ongoing conversation in my head. But my first thought, my foundational thought needs to be, how do we do this? It was one of the first conversations we had as elders when we first met as a board of elders. We said to each other, we have to figure out how to have conflict. And we're also happy to be there, and we love each other so much that actually, you know, it's like I don't know if we're going to have to invent something, you know. But we realized in that room, if we don't learn how to have conflict as elders, then we either all become yes men or become silently resentful of each other until the whole thing falls apart. And it's been fascinating, you know, it's been a great place for me just to bring up some of the stuff I'm like wrestling with theologically as I'm growing in my own theology and understanding of Scripture, and I can bring that up there. And it's been fascinating to sit in a room with people that don't all agree on those things, and we get to have the conversation. And nobody is like acquiescing or like pulling their punches because I'm the pastor and I've got this idea that I'm exploring. Like, we get to have this conversation and not everyone's on the same page. This is what the body of believers needs to be like. We need to know each other well enough to know that we disagree, because that forces us to learn how to accept each other even if we don't approve. Because what is going on in the world around us? How many people, individuals, and groups of people are dying for lack of Jesus? Because we can't accept them because we don't approve of them. The world around us is starving for this, and we are too. We just don't realize it. Maybe it's because we misunderstand what church is supposed to be. Maybe it's because we just don't know how to cross into those areas. But this is crucial for us if we want to understand forgiveness, if we want to live this Christian life of forgiveness, if we want to be the incarnation of God with Jesus as our head. We got to do this, man. Do you suddenly see how crucial a conversation around a round table at a potluck meal is? Not that I want you all to have to start arguments and be yelling and throwing chairs or anything like that. But man, why haven't you go to a Christmas dinner and you don't talk about religion, you don't talk about politics? You know, how do we figure out how to know each other to be able to talk about those things and not have it be contingent on our friendship? That's tough, man. That's hard. So, we're saved into this incarnational life. It must start here. And so it's on us to figure this out. And then we get to talk about it happening outside of this. And what's beautiful is this Sermon on the Mount, which comes up over and over again with us, this Matthew chapter 5 to 7, where Jesus sits down and teaches, and it's something he must have taught over and over again because it was able to come together, and Matthew is looking at it at this moment where he's sitting on the mount and he's teaching all these people, and he lays all this out. And it's beautiful because it's so clear and it's so laid out. It's also so frustrating because it's a little confusing and because we don't understand and because we've got a couple thousand years of history of trying to figure it out in all kinds of different ways. But we get to walk through that in the next few weeks. Now that we've got this idea of what where this all starts, we get to kind of build on it a little bit with Jesus' teaching. Don't take my word for it. Let's talk to Jesus about it. Amen? Let me pray. God, there's so much here, but there's something that we agree on. And I think this is something that you gave us, God. You gave us this idea that Christians are meant to be in us. You've opened our eyes, Lord, to your story that you placed within a group of people who kind of had actually not a whole lot of individual identity to begin with. So that when we read scriptures and we read it through the eyes of the people who heard it first, we come to understand that you're talking to people first and foremost. Jesus blew open this amazing door of being able to individually encounter you, God. To be able to relate to you as individuals, to be able to take responsibility for ourselves and our standing before you as individuals in embracing Jesus' sacrifice, Lord. And yet, too often we stop there thinking it's about us being saved, and we miss the entire reason that Jesus became a man, to show us how to live as humans, how to be more human after the fall of sin, how to sacrifice ourselves for each other, Lord, in this life of forgiveness. Father, I pray that you would lead us in this, that you would continue teaching us the way you promised in John 17. You'll continue to show us the Father. Help us figure out how to get to know each other in ways that are hard in our culture, Lord, so that we can learn to accept each other regardless of our approval or styles or temperaments or opinions, God. Because we don't need to look very far to see a world around us that is desperate for us. I'm desperate for this, Father. I'm desperate to be in communion with people that can know me for real and still love me. Because there's so many things about me, God, that I'm pretty sure if people knew about me, they would reject me and not want anything to do with me. And that means I'm not living in a life of forgiveness. Received or offered, God. So, Father, we ask you and we seek you out. We long for your movement in this body and in our hearts. Amen. All right. We'll continue next Sunday. Have a good week.